Good morning. Today we'll be discussing about the head injury. First, I would like to show you what are the parts of the brain, just for a brush up. Now, if you can see, these are the cerebral hemispheres. This will be the midbrain. This is the pons, and lower down will be medulla, continuing as a spinal cord. Going forward, what is trauma? Trauma originates from the Greek word meaning wound. Trauma remains the most common cause of death and disability in children and young adults worldwide. There are around 10,000 people who die as a result of the injury of head. What is AIS? It is the abbreviated injury scale. It is assigns an injury severity score between 1 and 6. The injury severity score provides an image of the anatomical severity of the injury suffered by the patient. Major trauma is defined as an ISS, that is the injury severity score greater than 15. Now, it is important that you understand Glasgow Coma Scale before we go further into head injury. Now, what is Glasgow Coma Scale? It is a scale that is used to clinically assess the severity of injury occurring in a patient. Now, it is taken up on the best eye response, the best verbal response, and the best motor response. Now, you can remember it as EVM, E for eye, V for verbal, and M for motor response. Now, E contains opening the eyes spontaneously, opening to verbal command, opening to pain, and no eye opening at all. They are graded as 4, 3, 2, 1. E is 4. Now, best verbal response is oriented responses, confused responses, inappropriate words, incomprehensible sounds, and no verbal response. V is 5, the maximum possible. The best motor response is the patient obeys the commands, that is 6, or he's able to localize the pain, or there is withdrawal from pain, or flexion to pain, extension to pain, and no motor response. So the highest possible score a person can attain in a Glasgow Coma Scale is 15, and the least is 3. This is important to remember, it is not 0. The least a patient can be given is 3 and not 15. Now, there are certain problems with this Glasgow Coma Scale, because now it is not acceptable for us to clinically cause pain to the patient. So in 2014, there has been a revision. Now, previously, in the table below, you can see that eye opening in number 2 and 3 were to pain and to sound. Now, it has been changed to pressure and to speech. Whereas in verbal response, it was incomprehensible and inappropriate words in 2 and 3 scoring. Now, this incomprehensible was changed to sounds, and the inappropriate words were just changed to words. Now, a further revision to the Glasgow Coma Scale is the addition of pupillary reactivity score. Now, what is this pupillary reactivity score? It is the unreactiveness of the pupils to the light. So, if both the pupils of the patient are unreactive to light, the score will be 2. If one pupil is unreactive, the score is 1. And if neither of the pupils are unreactive, the score is 0. You need to clearly understand this, that if the pupils are unreactive, the score is 2. And if they are reactive, it is 0. So now from the GCS, we deduct the pupillary reactivity score to obtain the final GCS P score. Supposing the patient has a GCS of 15 and both the pupils are reacting to light, which is 0, the patient's score remains as 15. Whereas if the patient has a GCS of 13 and his pupils are unreactive to light bilaterally, it is 2. So 13 minus 2, the new GCS score is 11. Now, why is this necessary? Because just taking the eye verbal response and the best motor response was found to be not an accurate predictor of mortality and morbidity. So with the addition of the pupillary reaction, there was a better prediction of the mortality and morbidity. Now, what is head injury? Any degree of trauma that occurs, ranging from a simple scalp laceration to loss of consciousness and focal neurological deficits, comes under head injury. Head injuries are amongst the most common types of trauma encountered in emergency departments. Many patients with severe brain injury die before reaching the hospital itself. and 90% of pre-hospital trauma-related deaths involve the brain injury. About 75% of patients with brain injuries who receive medical attention can be categorized as having only minor injuries, and 15% as moderate, and 10% as severe brain injury. What is primary brain injury? It is the damage sustained as a direct result of the impact on the skull. It results either from contact or inertial forces to the head that exceed the brain's ability to sustain that insult. Now, primary brain injury is essentially irreversible. It can only be prevented by asking the general population to wear helmets or seat belts and adhere to the road traffic rules. Now, our treatment is, because the primary brain injury is irreversible, our treatment is directed towards prevention of secondary brain injury. Now, what is secondary brain injury? It is the delayed brain insult that occurs within minutes, hours, or even days after the primary injury. The mediators implicated in this secondary brain injury are oxygen-free radicals, excitatory amines like aspartate and glutamate, cytokines, and other pro-inflammatory substances. Now, what constitutes the secondary brain injury? The rest of the all that we're discussing in this topic will come under the primary brain injury, whereas secondary brain injury is cerebral ischemia, cerebral herniation, hydrocephalus, electrolyte imbalance because of the primary brain injury. What are the common causes of head injuries? Road traffic accidents form the biggest cause, and then there are falls, mostly in the elderly patients. There are assaults, sports injuries, more common in the young, and firearm or blast injuries. Now, if head injury, death may occur at 3 points in time after the initial injury occurs. It can occur immediately after the injury. It can occur within 2 hours after the injury, or it can occur even 3 weeks after the injury. Now, what are the types of head injuries? They start with a simple scalp laceration, and then there are your skull fractures, minor head trauma, that is concussion and the post-concussion syndrome, and there is the major head trauma involving cerebral contusion and laceration of the brain tissue. Now, intracranial perfusion. What is Monroe-Kelly doctrine? For this, first we need to understand that the cranium is of fixed space. 80% of your cranium is made up of cerebrum, cerebellum, and the brainstem. 12% is the blood vessels and the blood, and 8% is the CSF. Now, if there is an increase in the size of one of this component, there has to be a decrease in the size of another component. Now, this leads to a rise in intracranial pressure. Scalp lacerations. These are the most minor type of head trauma. Now, you should understand that the scalp is a highly vascular area, and the major complication occurring here is infection. Now, what are the layers of scalp? You can use the mnemonic of scalp itself, where S stands for skin, C stands for the connective tissue, A for the aponeurosis, L for the loose areolar tissue, and P for the periosteum. Now, this is an image of a simple scalp laceration. What are the skull fractures? Now, the cranium is made up of 8 bones. The 8 bones are the ethmoid, the sphenoid, the frontal, the occipital, the 2 parietal, and the 2 temporal bones, all together forming 8. Now, the skull fractures come under the classification linear skull fractures, depressed skull fractures, basilar skull fracture, most common in children, diastatic skull fracture, again in children, compound elevated skull fractures, and the concept of coup and contre-coup injuries. Now, a linear skull fracture, as you can see in the image, there is a break in the cranial bone resembling a thin line. There is no splintering, there is no depression, or there is no distortion of the bone. What is a depressed skull fracture? The break in the bone with the depression of the bone towards the brain tissue, wherein it might itself cause a damage to the brain tissue. What are basilar skull fractures? Break of bone in the base of the skull. In this come the 2 important signs, that is the battle sign and the raccoon eyes. The battle sign is, if there is bruising behind the ears, it is called battle sign. And raccoon eyes are, there is bruising around the eyes. Now, the picture on the left is the battle sign, that is bruising behind the ear. And on the right is the raccoon eyes, the bruising around the eyes. Now, what is a diastatic skull fracture? It is fracture in one of the 8 bones that form the skull. It is usually in children less than 3 years because the suture lines are yet to fuse. Now, in diastatic skull fractures, there is a widening of the suture line, as you can see in the image. Now, what are compound elevated skull fractures? There is a fracture of a cranial bone with a segment that is elevated above the adjacent intact skull bones. Now, what is coup and contre-coup injuries? Now, when the patient has an injury, the initial assault might be on one end, but in the brain, the peculiarity is that the injury might also be found on the opposite end of the initial injury. So, when the patient presents to us, clinically, it is important to assess where the injury is. It might not be only at the site of primary impact, but there might be a secondary impact. Now, why is this? Because the brain is a structure that is held flimsily in the CSF. It is floating inside our head in the CSF. So now when the acceleration or deceleration because of the impact is too high, the brain is first pushed towards one side and later on it is pushed back against the skull itself again. So this is contre-coup and coup injury. Now the location of the fracture alters the presentation of manifestation. The patients might have facial paralysis, conjugate deviation of the gaze, and as we have already discussed, battle signs and raccoon eyes. Now, head injury classified according to the GCS score. Now, it is a minor head injury if the patient has a GCS of 15 with no loss of consciousness. It is mild head injury if the GCS is 14 or 15, but with a history of loss of consciousness. Now, moderate head injury is a GCS that is 9 to 13, and severe head injury if the GCS is 3 to 8. Now, minor head trauma, that is a concussion, the head injury with a temporary loss of brain function. It can cause a variety of physical, cognitive, and emotional symptoms. It is usually caused in sudden acceleration and deceleration injuries. The patients present to you with headache, loss of consciousness, or amnesia. The patient might also have a raised ICP with a Cushing's triad. Now, what is a Cushing's triad here? It is the irregular, decreased respiration, bradycardia, that is reduction in the heart rate, and the systolic hypertension. The patient might also have convulsions, confusion, irritability, and behavioral changes. Now, what is a post-concussion syndrome? It is the clinical condition after a concussion that might last for 2 weeks to 2 months. These patients have persistent headache, they are lethargic, and they have behavioral changes. Now, this is a table that shows the discharge criteria for patients with minor or mild head injury. So, if the patient has a GCS of 15 with no focal deficits, and if the CT brain when taken is normal, and the patient is not under the influence of alcohol or drugs at the time of presentation, and the patient is accompanied by a responsible adult to either bring back the patient in view of the following features. We have to explain to the patient and their attenders by a written and verbal advice to seek medical advice if the patient has persistent or worsening headache despite analgesic use, if the patient has persistent vomiting, if he has drowsiness or there is visual disturbance and limb weakness or numbness. In case of these symptoms, the patient is asked to present back to the hospital. Now, when should we take a CT? The indications for CT imaging within 1 hour are GCS of less than 13 at any point after the injury, GCS of less than 15 at 2 hours, the focal neurological deficit is present, there is suspected open, depressed or basal skull fracture, and there is more than one episode of vomiting or post-traumatic seizures. Now, indication for CT imaging within 8 hours are if the age of the patient is more than 65, if the patient has history of usage of drugs like aspirin or warfarin, if there is a dangerous mechanism of injury, that is a fall from a height or a road traffic accident, and the patient has retrograde amnesia of greater than 30 minutes duration. What is a major head trauma? It is the cerebral contusions and lacerations. Now, cerebral contusions, the bruising of brain tissue within a focal area, maintaining the integrity of pia and arachnoid layers. Now, what are these layers? I'll be discussing shortly. There is associated multiple microhemorrhages and small blood vessel leaks into the brain tissue. I repeat again, what is cerebral contusion? The bruising of brain tissue within a focal area, while maintaining the integrity of pia and arachnoid layers, there is associated multiple microhemorrhages and small blood vessel leaks into the brain tissue. Now, a tear involving the brain tissue is a laceration, and usually it is accompanied by intracerebral hemorrhage. What is a diffuse axonal injury? The widespread axonal damage occurring after mild, moderate, or severe traumatic brain injury is a diffuse axonal injury. It is seen in half the cases of traumatic brain injury. it occurs 12 to 24 hours duration after the injury, and there is 90% regainment of consciousness in the patients. What are the clinical signs? There is altered level of consciousness and altered ICP. There is decerebration and decortication. So what is decerebration? Involuntary extension of the upper extremities and arch back of the head with the arms and legs extended and internally rotated. Involuntary extension of the upper limbs, arch back of the head, arms and legs extended with internal rotation. Now what is decortication? Here it is the flexion of the upper limbs or bent inwards onto the chest with the hand clenched into a fist. Now why are these signs? We can know if the patient is having decortication or decerebration. What is intracranial hemorrhage? It is again divided into two components, extraaxial and intraaxial. Extraaxial is, it does not involve the brain tissue per se. It can be divided into epidural, subdural or subarachnoid. What is intraaxial? It is the bleeding that occurs into the brain parenchyma or into the intraventricular space. Now, what are the ventricles? We have the two lateral ventricles, the third ventricle connecting to the fourth via the aqueduct and the fourth ventricle. Now, what constitutes the extraaxial hemorrhage? It can be epidural, that is bleeding within the layers of the dura, subdural, bleeding between the dura and the arachnoid, and subarachnoid, that is bleeding below the arachnoid layers. If you say this is the brain, cerebral hemispheres, the midbrain, the pons, the medulla, and the spinal cord, the closest innermost layer that is densely adherent is called the pia. So this is the pia. Above that, we have the arachnoid. This is arachnoid. Now on top of the arachnoid layer, we have the dura. But the dura is made up of two layers, the inner meningeal layer and the outer endosteal layer. So now if the bleeding occurs between the two layers of the dura, it is called epidural. If it occurs between the dura and the arachnoid, it is called subdural. If it occurs below the arachnoid, it is called subarachnoid. Intraaxial is bleeding intraparenchymal and intraventricular. Bleeding within the brain parenchyma is intraparenchymal, and intraventricular is bleeding into the ventricular system. Now, what are the layers around the brain? As I have shown, it is the dura mater with its two layers, that is the endosteal and meningeal, the arachnoid mater below the dura, and the innermost, that is the pia mater. Now, we have already seen that there is a skin with skin aponeurosis, periosteum. Below that is the bone. Below the bone, from outer to inner, are the dura, arachnoid, and pia. What is an epidural hematoma? Epidural hematomas are found in 4% of traumatic brain injury patients, and they mostly occur in the region of the temporal bone because it is fragile and it is a thin bone. So 70 to 80% of epidural hematomas are seen here. Now, what are the vessels involved? They are the middle meningeal artery, the dural venous sinuses, and the bridging veins. Now, clinical presentation in epidural hematoma, it is important to remember these three, that is a lucid interval, the Hutchinson's pupil, and the Kernohan's phenomena. Now, what is a lucid interval? The patient has an injury, there is a loss of consciousness. After a few minutes or few hours, the patient regains consciousness for a few minutes or a few hours, and once again falls back into loss of consciousness, which is permanent. Now this middle interval where the patient is conscious is the lucid interval. Now this is present in epidural hematoma. Now what is a Hutchinson's pupil? The patient has a hematoma on the right side. The pupil on the side of the injury, that is the right side, will be unresponsive to light. Now that is called the Hutchinson's pupil. Now, what is Kernohan's phenomena? Now, for that, now, this is again the cerebral hemispheres, the midbrain, the pons, and the medulla. Now, here there is tentorium cerebelli. Now, when there is bleeding here between the layers of the dura, epidural hematoma, this causes this side of the brain to push downwards. Now, when this pushes downwards, this part of the midbrain is pushed on the opposite side. So, the brainstem, midbrain here is impacted on the tentorium cerebelli on the opposite side. Now, how is this important for us clinically? Now, we know that the corticospinal tracts that control the motor responses, they originate here in the cortex and they come down and cross over to supply the opposite side. So, now initial insult is on this side. The midbrain is compressed on the opposite side. So, the patient develops loss of motor system responses on the same side of injury as the initial injury. While it is a conventional wisdom to think that because the injury is on the right side, patient may develop motor response loss on the left. But in Kernohan's phenomena, because of the compression of the midbrain on the tentorium cerebelli, there is a loss of motor responses on the same side of injury. This also occurs in epidural hematoma. Now, as you can see, this is a CT image of an epidural hematoma occurring between the two layers of the dura. What is subdural hematoma? These are generally divided into acute, subacute, and chronic. It occurs below the layer of dura, in between the dura and arachnoid. The most commonly involved vessels are cortical vessels and cerebral veins. Acute subdural hematoma is found more in the temporal and frontal areas. The patient presents with altered consciousness, dysphagia, hemiparesis, hemiplegia, and raised ICP. Now, the surgical evacuation of a subdural hematoma is to be done if the acute SDH is greater than 10 mm in thickness, if the acute SDH has a midline shift of 5 mm, if the GCS is less than 8 with a raised intracranial pressure of greater than 20 millimeters of mercury. Now, what is the normal ICP? It is 7 to 15 millimeters of mercury. Now, if the patient has GCS less than 8 and fixed dilated pupils, also we need to do a surgical evacuation. Now, this is an image of a subdural hematoma. Now, what are the two differences between epidural and subdural hematoma? First of all, the location. Epidural is between the skull and the dura, in the layers of the dura, whereas subdural is between the dura and arachnoid. What are the symptoms? The most common epidural has a lucid interval, whereas subdural, there is an increasing headache. Now, why is this? In the CT appearance, you can see that the epidural is biconvex, whereas subdural is crescent shaped. Now, epidural is limited by the suture lines, whereas subdural is not limited by suture lines. Now, you can see there is epidural hematoma between the layers of the dura, subdural below the dura. Now, this is another image depicting the same thing. What is subarachnoid hemorrhage? It is the bleeding that occurs below the arachnoid layer. The most common cause is perianeurysm, especially in the circle of Willis, or due to trauma leading to internal carotid artery aneurysms or vasculitis or blood dyscrasias. Now, what is circle of Willis? It is formed by the following blood vessels. Now, the two vertebral arteries, the right and the left, join together to form the basilar artery. Now, this is your vertebral artery. These two together join to form the basilar artery. Now, the basilar artery gives many other branches, but they are not required for the circle of Willis right now. The important branch required for circle of Willis is the two posterior cerebral arteries, Now, the internal carotid artery, after it comes out of the cavernous sinus,
on the left and on the right. This is internal carotid artery. It gives rise to the middle cerebral artery, and the anterior cerebral artery. This is anterior cerebral artery. This is middle cerebral artery. Now, the middle cerebral artery and the posterior cerebral artery are connected by posterior communicating artery. There are two, one on the left, one on the right. And there is an anterior communicating artery that is between the anterior cerebral arteries. This is the circle of Willis. And it is the most common site for Berry aneurysms. Now, why is this important here? We should understand that the blood supply of the brain is predominantly in the subarachnoid space. It is not directly on the brain tissue. If a hemorrhage occurs here, this is subarachnoid space. So there will be subarachnoid hemorrhage. Now, this is an image of the same circle of Willis. You can see the basilar artery, the posterior cerebral arteries, the middle cerebral artery from the internal carotid artery on right and left, and the anterior cerebral artery, once again, the right and left coming from the right and left internal carotid arteries. Now, what are the clinical features of a subarachnoid hemorrhage? It is an explosive or thunderclap headache. Usually, the patient tells you this is the worst headache of his life. He also has nausea, vomiting, and decreased consciousness, and signs of meningeal irritation. I'm not sure if you'll be clearly able to make out, but this is the subarachnoid hemorrhage here. Now, what is intraaxial hemorrhage? There are two main types, that is the intraparenchymal and intraventricular. Intraparenchymal is most commonly due to hypertensive vasculopathy, whereas intraventricular occurs due to trauma. Now, here you can see this is an intraparenchymal hemorrhage. One more image showing intraventricular bleed. Now, what is the clinical presentation of intraparenchymal? There is rapidly progressive severe headache building up over several minutes with nausea, vomiting, and decreased consciousness. Now, what are the complications of a head injury? The patient might have neurological deficits, seizures, obstructive hydrocephalus, spasticity, aspiration pneumonia, neuropathic pain, or cerebral herniation. Now, the management. The investigation most commonly done is a CT scan. It is indicated if GCS is less than 15 with no history of intoxication. MRI is superior for demonstrating the size of acute subdural hematoma. However, it is difficult to obtain an MRI because the patient should be immobile. In a subconscious, altered consciousness patient with an irritable meningeal signs, it is difficult to stabilize the patient. So most immediately obtained are the CTs. We can also have a cerebral angiogram, a cervical spine x-ray to rule out cervical fractures, lumbar puncture to be done only if the ICP is not raised. Kindly remember, lumbar puncture is absolutely contraindicated if the patient has any signs of raised intracranial pressure, and an EEG can also be obtained. Now, what is the A, B, C, D, E of trauma care? The first is a C, that is control the massive external hemorrhage. Because if the patient is losing blood, there is no point in us intubating him or stabilizing him. As long as he's losing blood, we are not going to save him. The first thing we do is we control the massive, obvious external hemorrhage. Next, the airway is stabilized with a cervical spine protection. Next, the breathing and ventilation of the patient are stabilized, followed by the circulation and hemorrhage control. Next, any disability is assessed via the neurological status. And the patient is completely exposed for assessing any other injuries that we might have missed initially. Now, what are the supportive measures given to the patient? Endotracheal intubation for patients with decreased consciousness or poor airway protection. We have to gradually lower the BP to a mean arterial pressure less than 130 mm of mercury and avoiding excessive hypotension. The newer concept is a certain level of hypotension is acceptable. Because reperfusion injuries are far more dangerous if we do reperfusion very fast. Next, rapidly stabilize the vital signs and acquire a CT. Maintenance of euvolemia using normotensive rather than hypotonic solutions is important to maintain the brain perfusion without exacerbating the edema. We have to avoid hyperthermia and then transfer the patient to an operation theater or a ICU. Now, the decreasing edema, how to decrease the edema? Passive hyperventilation to reduce the PSCO2. Mannitol is given 0.5 to 1 gram per kg body weight, slow IV. Furosemide is given 5 to 20 milligrams IV. Head is elevated to 20 to 30 degrees, provided there is no cervical vertebra fractures, and sedation of the patient if it is necessary. Now, evacuation of a hematoma. When to evacuate the hematoma? No surgical intervention if the collection is less than 10 ml. There is self-absorption. The indication for decompression are if the GCS decreases by 2 or more between the time of injury and hospital evaluation. So, supposing the initial trauma responders, that is our ambulance staff, have assessed the GCS to be 13. Now, by the time the patient comes to the hospital and you assess it, if it becomes 11, we have to evacuate the hematoma, if there is one. If the patient has fixed dilated pupils, an urgent evacuation of the hematoma is indicated. Or if the intracranial pressure is greater than 20 millimeters of mercury. How do you decompensate that? You can do a burr hole, you can do a craniotomy, you can do a craniectomy, or you can do a cranioplasty. Now, what is a burr hole? It is a small hole made in the skull with a surgical drill. It is done for a variety of reasons, to evacuate blood or to pass a drainage catheter to drain the CSF or for making a bigger craniotomy. Now, this is an image of a burr hole. Now, here the patient was placed a drain. What is a craniotomy? The surgical removal of a part of the bone from skull to expose the brain. It is done for the following reasons: aneurysm clipping, for a biopsy, for aspirations, or for radiosurgery in malignancies. Now, this is a temporary procedure and the bone flap is replaced after the completion of the procedure. It is of two types, most importantly, that is a stereotactic craniotomy and an endoscopic craniotomy. This is an image of a craniotomy. The skull piece was removed, the dura is cut open, and the brain is exposed. What is a craniectomy? It is a surgical removal of a portion of the skull to relieve pressure on the underlying brain. Here, after the removal of any underlying clot that is compressing the brain, there may be further edema because of the injury. Now, if we do not remove a part of the cranium, the brain, because of the edema, is forced to compress downwards, injuring the other brain's tissues. Now, because we remove this part of cranium, the edema is given an outlet to grow. Now, once this subsides, we may put back the removed portion. This is called craniectomy. This is an image of a craniectomy. You can see here, this portion of the cranium was removed. And once the swelling has subsided, they have placed it back again. What is a cranioplasty? It is a surgical repair of a bone defect in the skull that is left behind either due to the injury itself or a previous surgery. There are various cranioplasties, but most involve lifting the scalp and restoring the contour with an original piece or a graft. The commonly used grafts are titanium grafts or acrylic grafts. Now, here you can see this patient, it is clearer in this image, has lost a part of a frontal bone. A graft was placed and they could finally get the normal contouring.